Welcome to Admin Reporting Live for Premier Magazine from the EIG workshop. We are here with Kim Okoski, who is the director of CSC, and we talk a little bit about CSC and the Eurasia. So welcome.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Can you tell a little bit about yourself first?
Yeah, so I've been now 15 years CEO of CSC, so and back since 2004, and before that I have some experience in Nokia, like everybody in Finland practically those days, and but actually I have been in CSC also in 1990s, pretty much responsible for research infrastructures at this time, and but since 2004 CEO, so. So I've been quite a long experience about this, the national centers and how they have been evolving since. Because first time when I joined CNC 89, I think we were about 30 people, and today we are over 400. So there has been quite a lot of.
So we were here at the EIG workshop, which is coming to a close very soon. So. What do you think about the workshop? Your experience?
Yeah, I think it's very nice. I mean, something like 60 people here, right? And a lot of expertise around. I wasn't present the whole workshop from yesterday afternoon. Today morning I had another meetings, but if I understood right, the workshop was also quite going well today. I think it's interesting topics, and good to get the colleagues together, and you can have a lot of offline, also other discussions, not only in the workshop, but also outside.
Coffee
hour discussions, you know this.
So these are sometimes the more interesting discussions.
Yeah, we are pretty happy about this autumn, because due to the Finnish presidency, we have got quite a lot of interesting seminars, also organized in Finland.
Yep. There was quite a variety of topics, you could say, from artificial intelligence to lifelong learning to EuroHPC.
Yeah.
And they were all more or less connected by competences and creating competences, things like that.
Yeah.
Is it something that also CSC is focusing on, or what's the goal of the National Center?
Yeah, I think, of course, one of the goals is that we need to provide the services to our users, which is typically the researchers in the universities and polytechnics and research centers, but also people from the cultural side or information management services for universities, etc., or the government services. But you can't do that without constantly focusing on competence development. So because we are growing, we need new people, we need to teach them, and state and university-owned non-profit company. So our target is not only that CSC would do fine, but our main target is that Finland is competitive and successful, and this actually involves quite a lot of competence development. So we want to train good people, and we don't mind if they transfer from us to some of the industry, as long as they pay their taxes and they employ people here.
And you're focusing on, let's say, on ICT in general, or just for research?
This is quite the interesting topic, because for historical reasons in Finland everything is centralized to CSC. So the other countries, they have different units, many times hooked to universities. The research network is a different unit, but in Finland everything is under the same roof. So also we are running the national network. And we are taking care of the supercomputing and cloud services, or different kind of computing services, data infrastructures. We are even serving the libraries, archives, museums, talking about things about open science, open data, and for example, long-term preservation. And then more and more we are also serving the government in certain areas like authentication or ICT projects, etc. So it's a very wide spectrum of users, but the origin of CSC is in high-end computing and research networks.
Yeah, and then you had this paper mill empty somewhere in the middle of the country,
and you thought,
let's put a computer there. Is that how the... Because you're one of the three centers which is hosting entity, I think that's the official name, for
Euro HPC. Cool. Yeah, that's a very optimal data center for Euro HPC, but actually we have been running in production there since 2012. So I think it was something like 2010 when, just for fun, we started to think about that whether it was computer systems, because they were using a megawatt or something like that of computing power, whether we should have an extension of our data center outside of the Helsinki area somewhere else. So we just took some of the bits. Okay, it happened to be that UPM, United Paper Mill, which is one of the biggest forest companies in the world, they happened to have paper mills empty or half empty. Well, it was not empty, there was a huge paper machine, but it was not anymore in use. And UPM happens to also have electricity infrastructure, so it turned out to be quite suitable for this. So due to some interest of searching for possibilities and accident and good luck, accident means that we just ended up there in Kajaani. And the decision we based was actually facts are today different than when we based the decision for, but so now we are happy users there, and it has been turned out to be excellent choice.
Yeah. So for the Lumi supercomputer, as it's called, the consortium, you brought together a large number of countries already, and then of course it's Euro HPC, which brings in also money and also users. So there will be users from all over Europe.
Yeah. Exactly.
And how will you handle that?
Well, this of course is a good question. So, but in our case, we have been in this business quite long. So, actually, the company, we calculate our history from 71, but the first supercomputers came in the late 80s to Finland, and so we have a long experience of how to run the systems and get users into that. And also, the Finnish science has a long tradition in high performance computing and programming there. But of course, it's a challenge, and we have to remember that all of these three machines, half of the cycles belong to Europe. It's a European research, us included, but everybody else. And then the rest of the other half of the cycles, depending on the funding ratio, is distributed to those countries who are funding. In our case, 9 countries share it. In Spanish and Italian case, it's a different consortium, and they also share it. So there will be quite a lot of resources, and our main thing is, of course, that we want them to, first of all, have a maximum positive impact in science and research and innovation too. And the other thing is that you have to prepare that when the systems are available, it already has to be overbooked, with a good code.
Yeah.
So we have put a lot of emphasis on the how we prepare the users to use these systems, how they can get most out of it.
Yep.
And this is now one of the things we have to realize here also in Europe, that we can't stop, for example, investing when we now have invested on machines. Now we need to invest on people everywhere, not only in here, but everywhere.
Yeah. But people are, of course, most important, because they need to use it, and you need people to train researchers. But from a technology perspective, I mean, one of the visions was that researchers would have seamless access to these systems.
Exactly, yeah.
But with the large amount of data that's involved in HPC, with the big machines, you need more data anyway. How will that happen?
Well, that will happen, and I know, and in some areas anyway, of course, the data challenge can be bigger than in some other areas, so it depends. But I mean, we have been running, there's quite a lot of discussion over the years, because we have been competing about different projects, etc. And quite often the argument comes that Kajaani, where we have this data center, 600 kilometers north from Helsinki, so that it's far and you can't, it's difficult with the networks, but actually the network, the fiber is going there from four directions, and it's actually one of the best network places in Europe. So it's not really a problem. But of course there are research infrastructures that are generating huge amount of data, like CERN, or for example the square kilometer array some of the others, that the having data anywhere will be a problem. Challenge. But I mean, then it has to be taken case by case. But I mean, what we have been doing now here in Finland, so really we have been running a remote data center since 2012, and that has never been, in our scale, hasn't been a bottleneck. I mean, the data connections. Now, of course, with even higher amount of resources, there will be more and more demanding challenges. So I expect that in some areas we need to put a special focus on data, but it will not stop it. So most of the cases it will work quite fine, like it works also in Bologna and Barcelona and any other European big places. So, but having said that, at the same time, the tendency is that now, for example, now we are also replacing our national systems this year and early next year. So, and then the following year, Lumi starts to be in. So we would have never got the budget for national system if we are looking for the budget for supercomputing. But we got a budget for data-intensive computing devices with some AI flavor.
Okay.
So it's practically the same thing, but anyway, that demonstrates that the focus nowadays is more and more in data, not only in computing. And so we will end up with some kind of challenges, I think, which we don't even know now, but that will be interesting. We need to solve them, of course.
Yeah. Otherwise it would be boring.
Yeah.
I mean, buying a machine, running.
Yes, everything smoothly. Eh?
Yeah. So coming back now to the person, so how do you see the development of the skilled people there?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, that's one of the key things that we need to make it work. Not only here but everywhere. So we have these 9 country collaborations. So we will now, because it's about 1 year before the system will be hopefully in production. So we are, of course, need to focus now when we have got all the contracts stuff done, or most of that, kind of focus on this content and on these people. How do we, for example, together build competencies? We should share and actually use the synergy between the centers in code development, for example. So it's a good idea to develop code only once, not in 8 places. There is the national need for competence development. Then there is a Lumi, this 9 country collaboration need for competence development, and then of course the whole Europe and globally. So now it will be interesting now that how well we can work together as a team of these 9 countries, how well we can work together with the colleagues in Italian and Spanish centers. So now we are starting to discuss about that. But one of the guiding principles already in the day one, even if Finland is investing a huge amount of money in Finnish scale, I mean 50 million euros for this Lumi environment, our ministry also already in the beginning said that they are actually not investing on computing resources, they're investing on competence development platform.
Yep.
So what we want to do there is, of course, to support the science, but at the same time make new people learn things and actually focus on this computational science and especially AI-related topics too, where there is a huge need for more and more resources, people, human resources.
In the consortium that you have, will you try to decide on specialities so that it could be that a Belgian researcher is helped by, I think Poland is also involved.
Poland is involved, yeah.
By Polish support people, if that just fits.
Yeah. So this is the idea, and this is something that we are now starting to discuss now, because all kind of practicalities have been dominating so far. So that's one thing, and of course we also should and we start to discuss about how do we divide this, how do we profile with the other centers. There are certain overlaps. Yeah. When there are overlapping areas, the good idea is to try to find a way to do the things only once and share it to everybody. And then there are some areas where there is less overlap, but there's the possibility to complement each other. So then we could bring, for example, different researchers together to innovate something new. So there are a lot of opportunities, but it requires person work and coordination. Yep. And this is how we want to get all of our research communities to activate, or to be active in order to benefit from this.
Yep. And then, of course, has to be the coordination with EuroHPC and EuroHPC countries, which are not part of your consortium.
Exactly, yeah. And we need to support, half of the machine belongs to all of the European users, and or cycles belongs to all of the European users. Yeah. And, of course, because we are running a European resource, our responsibility also to make sure that all the European users will get a good service.
Yep. On the European scale, the intention is that there is a competence center, HPC competence center in each country.
Yeah.
Of course, you're involved.
Yeah.
And that then these work together on supporting users in individual users.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Is that a good model?
I think it's a good model, but it's only one model. It helps for the part of the. I hope it will help for the part of the challenges, but of course. There's a lot of other things we need to do also to train the users. Now the competence center call just finished, and so we filed the application. I assume that most of the 30 Euro HPC countries also put their application in, and depending on most of all, I don't know, but most of them probably. And so, but we don't actually know. We haven't yet gone through that who does what. So it will be very interesting now when the call has closed and beats it in, and when it will be published, that people know that what are the interests of the other countries in this competence center call, because this way we can also collaborate with these resources. The idea is definitely also to put a kind of make a kind of a human network about this, so we can benefit from the skills of the others and vice versa.
Yeah, but these centers will have quite different experiences from. Countries with just one small center to countries with a complex network of centers.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, and the program will run for only 2 years.
Yeah.
So it seems like very complex, lot of work.
Yeah. I think it's a start. I mean, the hints from the Commission also have been that if it works, they will continue next round, etc. So maybe hopefully it will. We'll have a continuation, but just saying that this is a very good, I think, good initiative, but it alone is not, of course, far from sufficient, because there is so much more work to do. So this will help with, let's say, if you take the maximum 1 plus 1 million for 2 years, you maybe get something like 10 people, 5 to 10 people, depending on what else you do with this. Per competence center, okay. I think we should somewhere find quite a lot of more people involved in the development and helping. Let's say the code development to accelerators or GPUs alone it's a lot of work. But if that will done efficiently, that will pay back.
Of course, you also have centers of excellence for application areas.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
It's not like it's only one. But indeed, there's a lot of work to do and a lot of coordination to do.
And I think it's one of the interesting is because I think much of the three European, the new pre-exascale centers, they have at least bits will probably be somehow dominated, or at least a big role is in accelerator GPUs, and the code development issue is of course there. On the other hand, it's a big opportunity, for example, to these artificial intelligence type of applications, so data analytics, where they might fit very well, these kind of things. And the things are developing, and more resources will be available also in the countries. So it's not these three centers is not the only computing system in Europe. But how can we make sure that they are new engineers or researchers coming up from the education and training pipe? To be able to use and apply these, take a benefit out of the resources. So at the same time, when we are focusing on existing high-quality research in Europe, we should now start all kind of training programs to focus on the next generation of people who are coming to the system.
Yeah. So otherwise, they just use their mobile phone to do calculations.
Yeah.
Users that will also could benefit are people from industry, from SMEs or from engineering companies, financial companies. How do you see the involvement there or the support there?
Yeah, that's interesting. So practically, I think the optimal status would be that, for example, the pre-exascale systems, 20% maximum would be used for industry.
Yeah.
Some of the centers have been successful with working with industry. Some of the centers have done less of that, and we don't have actually we don't have that that much experience necessarily everywhere about this. How to work with industry, and this is now this opportunity to learn that, and use the expertise of the others. Also, in some of the consortiums or the European countries involved in EuroHPC, there are some countries who have done a lot of commercial. France, actually Luxembourg, even, and Czech Republic. I think IT for Innovation is now a consortium. It's a industry focus, at least in some stages. And then some of the very very academic. And now, how to be able to combine these two, and actually then think about the startups, for example, who start from academics and sometime they end up to be industry or commercial companies. So there's an area which is actually in both sides. So we need to find ways to tackle those. That's one of the areas where we try to develop from the current.
Yeah, in that sense, it's a pity that neither Germany or France or the UK is involved in the exit skill systems, because especially Germany and Edinburgh, the UK, they have a lot of experience with helping companies.
Yeah, so. But actually they are involved. They are not investing in pre-exit skill systems at the moment. But they have their own systems. But they can of course use part of it, because half of the system is European, so they are involved in that sense, and they are actually paying part of the bill, of course, especially in Germany in terms of the European funding. But so we need to also look at this pre-exascale centers. It's just one piece in the puzzle. So there will be the next steps and the following ones, etc. So and I think the resources and this kind of thing is going to be. Well, I mean, the next phase, I mean, Germany and France probably have plans for the next steps on EuroHPC, for example. Yeah. But this remains to be seen, because we are talking about the funding of the next framework program, and this is not yet decided. But this will be one of the focus areas in development anyway, so one way or another they are involved, and already now quite actively, I think, in this JU governing board. New chairman is German, for example.
So thank you very much for this interview.
Yeah. Thank you very much also for you. It was the most interesting discussion,
Okay. For Primo Magazine, this was Adam Rivoli.